In today's panel, we have a very diverse group. Let me introduce myself. My name is Cia Linares. I work for Keysight Technologies, and I'm the director for R&D and business for our quantum engineering group. Today we have Faye, Paulina, Markus, and Kiera, and I'll let them introduce themselves.
I'm Faye Wattleton, and I'm co-founder and director of EeroQ Quantum Hardware, who has sponsored all of these lovely bags that you all are carrying around at this conference. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Paulina Mazurek. I'm the CEO and co-founder of BEIT, which is all about hardware-agnostic quantum algorithms, bringing quantum advantage forward by several years already. And if you think about inclusion and diversity and quantum democratization, I'm not the physics PhD. I just graduated from human sciences. Thank you.
How's it going, everybody? My name is Markus Edmunds. I am currently the Director of People and Culture here at QCWare. I just started in March this year. I actually come from a pretty interesting background where I was a third-party recruiter, specifically within the quantum computing space. So a lot of these companies that are here today, such as IonQ, Zapata, et cetera, I've had the opportunity to work with at a very close level and, you know, kind of see some of their hiring initiatives and kind of take a broad view of the quantum computing landscape. So at the moment, I'm currently developing, you know, forward-facing initiatives within human resources, you know, promoting, you know, diversity, equity, and inclusion, of course, and, you know, also trying to find the top-tier talent out there while also maintaining as much diversity as possible, of course.
Awesome. Hi, everyone. My name is Kiera Peltz. I'm the executive director of Qubit by Qubit. We are a nonprofit initiative focused on quantum education and workforce development training. Over the last few years, we've trained about 20,000 students from 125 countries, ranging from students as young as middle school all the way up to current members of the workforce. And really heart and center of everything that we do is diversity and inclusion. So our belief with quantum is that we can fix a lot of the mistakes that we made with the classical computing revolution and make sure that DEIA is front and center of all of the training that we're doing. So we're not just expanding the pool of who's participating in the quantum revolution, but we're also changing who's in the pool.
Well, that's great to hear. We will have some questions near the end, but first I'm going to grill them on a couple of questions if you guys don't mind. So first of all, we talk about quantum democratization. What does that really mean to you, and what is the big vision? What is the big picture? What should we be striving for? Please feel free to jump in.
Yeah, I'm more than happy to start it out. So I think it's actually an interesting question because I think depending upon who you ask, they may have a different answer for it. So for example, some people may view quantum democratization as, you know, accessibility for all developers and scientists that are actually going to be, you know, kind of hands-on with these various technologies, you know, direct stakeholders, if you want to call them. You know, you ask other companies like IonQ, it's really anybody with an internet connection, and you ask myself, I think it's really expanded to everybody, including the indirect stakeholders, such as myself, because when it comes to quantum computing, obviously this technology is going to be touching, you know, everybody in, you know, many different ways, especially within, you know, chemistry simulation, finance, things like that as well. So in my opinion, unless we are kind of reaching all kind of parts of the world and not just the scientists that are actually going to be utilizing these technologies themselves, I don't think that we can necessarily say that we have democratize this technology quite yet.
Yeah, so I would second that and add one more group, meaning I would see the democratization as people getting access to the results. So if we think about new drug discovery and all of this stuff, I would really love to see like everyone, including poor communities, having access to those new drugs, which are there because of the quantum stuff we're working on.
Well, I think it'll be necessary to mobilize multiple segments of sectors of society. If we see this as kind of a piecemeal process that our individual companies will do what they can do, and while that is commendable, that really won't move the meter in a way that is commensurate with the level of and the enormity of the impact of the potential for quantum. The point of starting yesterday to get this underway, if we really want to talk about participatory democracy, that more than just the industry has a stake in what happens here and how it is employed and applied, then we're really already late. And it looks like we really haven't learned from the overlooks of the past, or the failings of the past. So I think we have a lot to do, and that means really engaging major sectors of civil society, the major institutions, the academies, the nonprofit organizations, the religious organizations. In the Age of Enlightenment, there was a feeling that people from those that were not a part of the technology had a stake to talk about how could this be used and how can we think about this to improve the world for individually as well as globally.
And I'll just touch on the education side. I think there's a lot of hype around quantum education. I think often we can think there's a lot happening, but there's still a ton of barriers to making sure that quantum education is accessible to all. And I'll just give an example. A few years ago, we piloted out an intro to quantum computing course, 2 semesters long, made for high school students and above without any prerequisites. And we had students from over 100 countries participate in this program. It was virtual with live instruction. We wanted to make it incredibly accessible, so we had closed captioning, we had lab sections for Spanish speakers or English as a second language. One thing that we didn't take into account is that we had over 800 students from developing countries that did not have access to computers and were taking our course. And so we quickly had to iterate and figure out how we could make our entire course mobile friendly. Most quantum platforms are not mobile friendly currently. This is something that is overlooked. So I think there's a lot of pieces in terms of democratizing the education process, making sure that students not just have access to training, but then they're able, for example, to get visas, to work actually for companies or go into academia. And that path is not clear, and there's still not a sustainable path there. So I think we have a long ways to go to making sure that all students actually have training and that it truly is accessible. So that will be just my second point. Over 95% of our students who participate in our program say they could not participate if our programs were not free. There are some quality programs out there, but they're very cost prohibitive. And so I think that's another area we need to be thinking about in order to democratize the space and democratize the knowledge in it.
But I think if we're not thinking about this holistically, to recognize that there are stakeholders beyond the industry, we will have modest effect and it will be the long journey home. I think we have to really look at where are the civil society institutions that really need to be brought into this conversation, into a dialogue. What are we going to tolerate? What will we not tolerate? The rules and the laws will follow us if we don't do that. And I just think that this is a technology that is bigger than just a piecemeal approach, and that time is now to take on the major sectors of society to say, you do not need to understand what goes on in a physics laboratory to think about what the implications are for your work and for society.
So I definitely think that we do have a big picture. It's definitely clear that we're behind. A lot of things are behind nowadays, especially after the pandemic. One more thing to add to the late game. But as we look into the different barriers and challenges that we're facing for democratization, what are some of the benefits? Why should Nathan, who walked out, care about this topic?
He obviously doesn't.
he clearly didn't, but why should he care? I mean, you guys mentioned and emphasized that we have done it wrong in the past with technologies and evolution of technology and access to that technology. What have we gotten wrong, and how do we get that right, and why should we get that right? What is the benefit of doing it right this time? Why should we push for that?
Yes. Go ahead.
I was just going to speak, obviously, from a practical perspective. Again, talent's huge. It's a huge roadblock, I think, from a lot of companies being able to grow and accelerate. So I think from a practical bottom line perspective, there's that. But I think we can also look to AI very easily and how we went wrong by not having diverse perspectives and people in the room who were actually going to be affected by these technologies. And so I don't think we have to look far to know why this has the potential to matter. I think we can also see from a lot of the work that we've been doing in the education space is that people are well, students, again, as young as middle school or university students who don't have a STEM background, they are really well equipped and positioned to get into this space. And so I think it's a huge question of like loss of talent and perspective. There's not a huge barrier if you're just putting out these programs to actually retain this talent and bring them in.
Yeah, exactly. So I was about to tell the same thing from BEIT's perspective. So we really want to attract talent, and everyone in the industry does, right? This is the first and the major thing that you need to take care of. If you want to be successful, if you want to go and do the breakthrough, if you want to get the technology out there and do something meaningful. So we really care about the talent, and we really need to teach people out there that you don't need to be the physics PhD, for example, and we don't hire physics PhDs unless they apply and they go through the process. But we search for smart people in math, in physics, in software engineering, who are willing to learn. So the entry barrier in this case, when you apply and get a job, is not as high as people see it. And this is also crucial to understand.
And I think it's going to really take a robust private and public partnership. We have already seen that with the Quantum Coalition, the Quantum Industry Coalition, and in Chicago there is the Chicago Quantum Exchange. And these are attempts to look at a more systematic approach to the task ahead, because the enormity of doing it piecemeal will get us where we are today in this conference, where there is not much diversity in evidence. And here we are as professionals in this work. And so we have to really, really look at other mechanisms to interface with those sectors and to also raise a consciousness that as we are engaged in developing this technology and its applications, what are the moral and the ethical and the governance frameworks that we are unleashing here that need to be answered in terms of how we make sure that it serves good for humanity as well as for our planet.
So with that in mind, what are the things that we're doing? I mean, yes, we're late. Yes, we've gotten it wrong. But what are some things that we are getting right?
Better.
Yes. What are some things that we're actually doing right today to move this effort along?
Well, we're having this panel.
Yes, we're having this discussion. So that's a good start.
That is a good start.
Yeah. But
yeah, I think there are some other bigger companies out there, such as, you know, IBM, that are putting out, you know, courses for people specifically trying to get involved within quantum computing. On top of that, I think they've devoted more than $100 million, or, you know, some large figure of money towards the further education within quantum computing. I do think, you know, as Kira had mentioned, we do need to take a look at the prices of, you know, what these kind of different educational platforms that we are providing to these people, you know, exactly what those are, you know, depending upon how much those cost, you know, who exactly are we targeting with these, you know, different kind of variables in place. But yeah, I'm sorry, I kind of lost my train of thought in the middle of that right there.
So what is QCWare actually doing to advance the access and diversity within quantum?
Right, so I think specifically when it comes to QCWare, it's a little bit difficult because our resources are constrained. I will say that the entire point of QCWare is to develop a platform that allows data scientists and engineers to run their code in quantum environments, essentially. Mm-hmm. I will say that we are a little bit constrained because of the software at the moment, but more than anything else, I think a lot of the times it is kind of more on these you know, bigger companies that have more of the resources and everything to kind of go out of their way and make it more accessible to people in these STEM deserts and everything kind of across the world to further the pool of candidates that, you know, we have available to choose from.
Or in Kiera's case, and you know, another type of company, which is a nonprofit company.
That as well.
Which again, it's focused on specifically on that. But even big companies like Keysight is not huge, but we are doing, we're making strides to increase diversity within our company, and as well as get, or even though our platforms are hardware based and that's not very accessible for people that don't have that kind of money, getting things in the cloud that does improve access. IBM has actually proven that they can put something in the cloud and people can actually use it. But I think that has a cap on people that don't have the science background. And so how do you see that progressing over time and getting access to those that just don't know quantum? I mean, I think the end users today are frustrated with the fact that the technology is not there yet to solve the problems that they want to see with the...
Well, but the technology wasn't there as we know it today in the computer age, in the age of computers. It evolved. I like to say to friends who say, why are you doing this work? And because you're not a scientist, you're not a physicist. And I say, well, I was on the board of Estee Lauder for almost 9 years, and I still don't know how to make lipstick. But I could understand what the implications were for that product and how people could use it to the benefit. And the company's social obligation to use its position for the betterment of women. And I think that what sometimes happens is that we get caught up in the science of our doing, and we don't remember that there are stakeholders in what I am doing that I need to think about what the implications are for those stakeholders. And they're not just in the physics lab. It's especially not just in the physics lab. The implications are, as this would appear to be, worldwide.
And I just want to go back and then comment on this as well, but go back to what are we doing right? So I think we get to sit at the intersection of academia, K through 12 education, government, and industry. And there's a lot of people who are stepping up. There's a lot of startups and large companies who are helping fund initiatives like ours. I'll just give an example. This summer, we piloted out an early quantum career immersion program because we kept on hearing from companies saying, you know, it's great that you do stuff in the K through 12 space, but we need talent faster and we want more diverse talent. And so we thought, you know, a huge barrier to entry is that a lot of internships aren't available until you're in a PhD program. So what if we can create a hands-on training and internship program for first and second year students from underrepresented backgrounds? So we'll train them for half of the summer, and then we'll actually pair them up with companies where they can get mentorship and real world industry experience with the hope that the following year, you know, they're taking on as full-time interns. And we had a number of large companies, Google and IBM, BP, and smaller companies like the Unitary Fund and QNECT step up and take this on. So I think there's a lot of people in this space who are doing the work. There's a lot of people we reached out to, though, as well, who have begged us to send along our diverse students who said, no, we don't have time or resources for that. And I think it's the requirement of everyone to create that space and to make sure that, you know, we're not going to create inclusive spaces if we don't all make some sacrifice and put in some work. So I think there's a lot of people doing great job. I think we need the entire ecosystem to participate for this to work.
And I think that we have two groups in here, right? So the first thing is how to attract talent and how to lower down this entry barrier for people who understand tech but maybe feel that they are not feasible or not good enough for quantum stuff, right? And this is the first thing. And the other thing is how to educate like end users or people who will actually not work for quantum companies, but just to make sure that they understand what the potential is, how this can impact their lives, how they can get involved, maybe not at the level of creating the technology, but maybe later on, maybe, you know, joining those companies and being ambassadors in their communities, or you know, bringing this closer to people, to end users, and advocating for the technology. Because if people are aware of what does it mean, they will not be afraid of.
That makes a lot of sense. So as we try to wrap up to give people some time to ask questions, what would be your call to action? What is it that you would like to see for next year's Q2B? I mean, yes, I would like to see more people in the room having this same discussion. Maybe we can get Nathan to be in the front seat. But what else would you like to see for next year?
I'd like to see a panel of some of the country's top civic leaders, religious leaders, talking about what the implications are. Because, you know, quantum will not enter an ecosystem of welcoming. There's a great deal of hostility as referenced to, with respect to the mistakes of AI and other technologies. And so when we talk about participatory democracy, how can you do that if you're not having a dialogue, if there's no conversation going on? If that what people imagine is there's something, you know, that's very disruptive coming and don't quite know what it is because it's too complicated. And that's on us to make sure that it's not too complicated. So that would be my dream, that we have a panel here that would speak to not just the sector and what's going on in the sector, but to imagine what it means for their sectors as a diverse audience, as a stakeholder.
Thank you, Faye. Paulina?
The rest of you don't have dreams for next year?
I mean, I'll definitely reiterate what you just said, absolutely. But outside of that, I think the biggest thing that I like to see is just furthering the education in, you know, America's, or not necessarily America, actually, just like in the world's youth more than anything else, you know, getting them more involved into, you know, quantum technologies at such an early age. I mean, just as a personal little tidbit from my background, I'm not technical at all, but I did do a couple computer science courses here and there, and I can just think back to the enjoyment and intrigue that I had when, you know, I opened up Terminal and typed in, you know, print hello world or something like that for the first time, and actually seeing that come to fruition in front of me. I think having something similar to that, but except mm-hmm. within this landscape, is going to be able to just further, you know, develop the interest in this field.
Yeah. And from my perspective, I would like to see the barriers being removed. And one of the examples might be like how foreign corporation, even though it's registered and incorporated in the US, gets access to paid POCs, to government grants, to other stuff like this. So in our case, we're incorporated in Delaware, all the IP belongs to BEIT Inc., Delaware company, and still we are not treated as the US company when it comes to grants and other stuff. So so there are more areas, of course, like this, and you know, getting the list of those and trying to address those stuff and trying to make all the stakeholders potentially accessing those openings would be a huge help and would definitely impact both democratization and the bigger picture of the quantum technology.
Thank you.
Well, I have many dreams. I have many nightmares. I think first and foremost, DEI, we can't just pay lip service to it. There are plenty of people who, no one here, but there are plenty of people who sit on panels and talk about all the great work their company's doing, and then you look at their C-suite, and it's a very homogenous group. And I think it's important that, like I said, everyone's doing the work, and then we're giving spaces to people who are doing the work. I think it's also very indicative of how many people who left the room really are caring and grappling with these topics. I think the second thing when it comes to democratization of just quantum knowledge is really there's a lot of piecemeal efforts going on. And I think what we've seen from our side, there's a lot of great efforts who just don't, you know, they're not connected to the larger ecosystem. And then there's efforts that are far more opportunistic and aren't really thought out that can really hurt and damage students. All it takes, quantum is a scary place for people to get involved in. We have one chance to get it right with students, and we have to make sure that it is quality from the beginning. And so making sure that we're not giving spaces and voices to people unless those educational efforts are well vetted. And then last but not least, funding, at least I can speak in the United States context, is still really driven through the National Science Foundation. And a lot of that funding goes through to very elite academic institutions instead of more on the ground community grassroots organizations like ourselves. And so when we talk about democratization, again, just because you're not within an elite academic institution, just because you don't have a PhD next to your name, does not mean you can't play an important role in this space. And so if we're talking about these things, and if the NSF is talking about areas like this, I would like to see action and kind of those actions follow through.
Thank you. Are there any questions in the room?
So thanks for all the insights. Faye and I have been doing this quantum ethics thing since 2018, and you know, we've talked about the size of the audience, and it seems like the interest has been stacked. You know, whatever we're doing, we're not quite doing it right. How do we get more people to care about topics like this? Because that's my wish for next year, is that whatever the panel looks like, you know, and last year it was on Zoom, not a lot of people came to that either, so how do we change this trend? Because it seems the industry is growing, the general attendance is growing, and yet interest in this area seems to be the same small set of folks. What are some ways that we can just get more people engaged?
Well, you and I have talked about this. I mean, maybe I'll let you talk to some of the people that you haven't talked to about this, but as you know, my view is that we should be bringing in some of the major leaders in the country in a dialogue. This is a trade gathering primarily of the industry. And that while that is not critical, that does not make a democratization process as broad as you're describing. Why this is necessary, and seems as though that there's even a doubling down. I came 5 years ago, as you know, and it seems more tradey now than it did then, as opposed to being open. Certainly not a diverse group of people. So maybe we should start a petition or have a statement out of this panel to the planning committee for next year. That we get some folks here who will really draw attention and that people want to hear. That they come from outside to say,
outside
outside the system. Because this is all about what's going on in quantum and, you know, within the sector, and how do you break that now so that there is a comfort level with engaging much broader, because this development is largely taking place in the private sector at the end of the day. This development of this technology, a sector that is under great suspect and great because of the prior abuses.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll step in and make a recommendation. So before climate change was sexy and everybody was talking about it, it took many, many years and a lot of people talking and having panels like this that were the room was pretty empty. I mean, nowadays we all starting to see the effect of climate change, and so we're all kind of talking about it. But I remember, I think a decade ago, Al Gore just being in a room that was smaller people. So they decided to bring in government people, high stakeholders within different industries and getting them in the room. I remember that one of the people was a singer from the Black Eyed Peas, and he just talked about climate change. So they brought key people from each individual industry and they made it popular.
Yeah,
so,
and also and the document I shared with you on archive, right? There was this research on the quantum democratization. What does democratization look like? What are the types of democracy, how this applies to quantum technology overall and different areas of quantum technology. And this was written in a simple language, like really bringing the bigger picture, but based on the facts and on the research. So if this type of publication, and this was new, like this year or late last year, are bringing forward and and more publications of this kind are going on, and more talks like this or other, and probably within the companies, like quantum companies, if like C-levels take care of the education and show why this matters, and that we should all try to focus on and take care of those quantum democratization nowadays before it's too late, then perhaps combined with the stars brought into the panel, we would have the bigger audience next year.
I propose we get Maroon 5 or Black Eyed Peas.
Yeah, I mean, as corny as it sounds, you probably would get a full room.
Probably.
One thing I'll just add in as well from the educational perspective, something that we've started doing with our students. Similar to if you take a cybersecurity course, you actually, at the high school or undergraduate level, you need to sign a form essentially saying that you know that you could do harm with the skills that you're learning, and that you will not only actively not do harm, but you will try to like neutralize that harm or do good. And so it's a form that we've actually had our students start to sign for the skills that they're developing out in quantum computing. It gets very easy to think about all the exciting things that we can do with quantum. But the fact of the matter is we don't know, actually, what is going to be possible. And we need to start preparing students, really knowing that they could be potentially learning about an incredibly dangerous weapon and developing out skills with this, and being aware of that. And so I think that's something that we've actually just been trying to do practically from the education side to really get them to understand kind of the gravity of what they're dealing with. I would love to see something similar from the private side, but just echoing, I think, Faye, your point, the time is really right, I think, to be engaging the public sector. Been a ton of kind of legislation and recognition in Congress and from the White House. And I think now is when we could really be making a push to be engaging them further on the potential ethical implications. And we do need to have this move beyond industry, and definitely making the circle of those that we're engaging with much broader to make sure those guidelines are guided by the common and public good.
And we should not be discouraged by the little guy who walked out on us. We should say, it'll be another year, and we'll try a different technique next year to get the room filled, because this is a long journey home.
Yeah.
There isn't a beginning, middle, and end, and it'll outlive most of us on this panel, certainly me. But we should not shirk the duty to get it started and to get it underway. Seems the challenge.
We had one last question from the public.
That actually was my question, but I have a follow-up one. So what is something that some people might try to help with inclusion and sort of bringing in the larger audience to have a say? What are things that, like, either from your own experience or not, what are things that actually aren't going to work? Right? Like, we can talk about all the things that we're doing and next steps, but what are things that maybe in your own experience that you just know are not going to
I can just start really quickly. Every university, on the education side, is whipping up their own, say, quantum summer camps for high school students. They're putting a grad student on it. They're saying, go develop out some slides, and voila, like, let's get some students in. I find this actually incredibly dangerous, that just because people are experts in this area, automatically leads to the fact that they are good educators. Being in education, especially in a field as complex as quantum, is incredibly difficult. And so I think we need to move beyond assuming we can put any expert on quantum in a room to educate, especially at the K-12 level, which is such a vulnerable population and incredibly impressionable. So I'd really like to see more oversight on those kind of educational efforts. I think also at the university level, the same thing applies. We have a ton of students who come to our program who have quantum courses at their university, and they say they are either a toxic environment for women or people of color to be in, or they are taught so terribly that they do not want to go through it, and so they end up coming into our programs. There, again, like, with this being so interdisciplinary, there needs to be more oversight into how this is being taught, I think, at the university level as well.
I think that really a lot of that, which is really important, could be in the category of self-governance. You know, how much self-governance within the industry is taking place. You know, sometimes we really don't. And I, you know, my background is in healthcare. And it's an industry that is renowned for not governing itself, which led to severe regulatory requirements in terms of the practice and the application thereof. And I think this is an opportunity to form groups within the industry that can engage in regulatory behavior that moves toward a consensus of what we will accept ethically within the organization. How will we govern that? What will be the rules? Because there are going to be rules. There will be laws. You know, it's just a matter of how onerous they are will depend on how vigorous we are in developing our own framework of conduct. And that requires us to really engage with a lot of sectors outside of quantum to inform those decisions and to fight it out. I'm sure there will be unpleasant conflicts with what the quantum professionals want to do, with what broader societal organization or sectors will say, no, that's going to be harmful. We can't do that. You can't do that, and we're going to fight you if you try to do it.
Well, thank you very much to the panel. I really appreciate the time I only saw two hands raised, but.
Yeah, that's what I thought I saw.
No, the gentleman behind me.
There probably isn't an easy answer to that. There probably should not be an easy answer to it because you've asked a very complex question. But if you don't engage people in that sector with the technology, with the creators of the technology, there is no hope for there to be some accommodation on balance.
And also the dialogue, right, between the industry and government and other bodies, just to increase the awareness and just to raise those threats which might appear in the longer term, and just start preparing for this and start to, I don't believe that I'm saying this, but put some regulations maybe early on, but you know, in agreement with the industry and all the stakeholders to prevent from such unpleasant techniques.
And I'm hopeful if we get more diverse people in the room who are making these decisions, that they are going to start to take into account more so what are the implications of what's happening. So that's something that makes me optimistic. I know a lot of the students that we work with on the younger side, they will not work and do not plan on working in an organization or making decisions that are at odds with the public good. And so that's something that at least keeps me optimistic and why I think it's so important that it might seem, you know, a 10 or 20 year horizon of getting those students in to have a seat at the table, but that's going to make a huge difference.
Where we start may not be where we end up, and this is a long journey that will need to be adaptive and accommodative with mutual self-interest being balanced. And so I think we all look for an answer. This is the answer. This is the end, you know, the solution to the puzzle. And one of the exciting aspects about the whole science possibility and the powers that this can bring about for our planet is that there is no beginning, middle, and end, and that this will challenge us. It should challenge us emotionally, but also intellectually, and hopefully give us great satisfaction that we will leave it a little bit better off than has happened in the past as technology has advanced.
Thank you for your question. I know that we've run out of time, but let me say that we can continue the conversations for sure. There's a happy hour right now, I believe, so we can have something to drink and continue this conversation, hopefully. And next year, we hope to see you again, and maybe bring a friend.
Next year, we're going to have some different people here.
Bring a friend next year. Thank you.